So we have seen what happens to one particle. You have seen that this one particle feels nothing because it's just free falling. And the matter is just kind of, with respect to some other frame, we would see kind of oscillating. But the particle, when it's at rest, as we have seen, doesn't feel anything. Two particles sees the mutual separation between one and each other, but this is not the complete story, because when we have seen there is these two modes, these oscillation modes that are overlapping one each other, and they cannot be perceived with two particles only. So let's now go for three particles. That are displaced along an L. So two pairs of particles, if you wish. So we are going to have one particle here, one particle here. This is one of the arms of your detector. Then you have another particle here and here. So if you wish, this is the other pair of particles along this other direction. We call it this one the X, which is, we can define as the component of a vector, S1. This one, the Y, which is the component S2 of a three-dimensional vector, okay? And a vector defining these two components is just our vector S, okay, in 3D. Good. And again, we set ourselves at rest. So that S, in the end, is going to be, if we now make it, this is the situation in 3D, if we now look for the vector in 4D, which is what we can deal with the full power of the equations that we derived, the components are just going to be these ones. Okay? And what is that equation that can tell us what is the behavior of a vector given the presence of curvature? We have seen it. And this is the geodesic deviation equation. Where we have a vector located on a geodesic, and then we were asking ourselves, how does this vector change in size as we are running along the curvature, along a geodesic line? But remember that we are in 4D, so running can be also a long time. So this can give you the evolution. So we just write down our geodesic equation. You see, it's associated to this sort of acceleration. Now the vector is defining the separation along the diagonal of these particles, which is nu gamma beta alpha u gamma u beta s alpha. So this is, need another letter. What is left? Sigma. Okay, good. So we have our geodesic equation. This is going to tell us how the length of this vector, if we are taking the space component, is going to change as a function of time. Now we take the non-zero terms of our Riemann tensor. And we have R alpha 0, beta 0, which is going to be, you know, we also have the constraints given by the symmetries. And they are going to be these ones. And they are equal, as we have seen in the previous lecture, to that in the TT gauge. Okay, so we know what is the Riemann tensor. And now that we know what is the Riemann tensor, we know how that vector is going to change. And as we see, the two components of that vector give us the separation, so the length of one arm and the length of the other arm of our detector, or if you wish, of the particles displaced in that configuration. We now just compute our components for the space part, which is what we are interested in. So we have the S1, so we are looking for the variation along the x of the tau square equal to 1/2 c square the x. And then we have our Riemann tensor, which components are these ones. Then we have the other arm, or again the variation of the x, the S2 square over the tau square equal to 1/2 c square the x, and then again the 2 H1 2 TT over the T squared. And then we go for the other component, the S square 1 over the tau square equal to 1/2 C square the Y, the square HTT 1 2 over the T squared. And the last one, D, which is the square S2, yes, over the tau square, 1/2 c square, the y, and then the square of HTT, 2 over delta t squared. Okay, so what I just did, I just used the, expressed the two space components of the vector S that I care about, which is this component and this component. Okay? So it is just all the possibilities I have for that. And this expresses, the first two expresses the pairs in X, so the pairs of particles in X. So the horizontal arm. And this is the pair of particles along Y. So this is the vertical arm. Now we can look at the polarization modes now, because we can, for example, set H12TT equal to 0, so that we see only one polarization mode. And the only non-zero component are going to be the E and D, so the first one and the last one. So that we have, you see, we have an oscillation of the x and the y. Oscillation of the x and oscillation of the y. This corresponds to the plus mode. We have an oscillation that goes like that. Okay, that's the plus mode. Then we look at the other terms. We can set for H11 equal to 0. As well as H22, so we are setting to 0 the diagonal components, TT, TT gauge always, and in this case you see that the B and C terms are the one different than 0, and this is going to give us an oscillation that goes like that. You see? The S2, which is the length of the value, the component of the vector of the x component is oscillating with respect to the x, and vice versa, S1, that refers to the x component of our vector, is oscillating with respect to the y component. So it's the way around. And this is referring to the cross polarization mode. Okay? So this shows you that those polarization modes that we are coming up by splitting the terms of the diagonal and the off-diagonal terms in our epsilon matrix, and that were referring to an ellipsity 2, as we've seen, this is reflected in the motion of particles. So you see that In this way, you understand why we need detectors that are shaped like that. You know, that we have the two arms, for example, in LIGO and Virgo, and the other detectors that are going to be produced. And you see how this is going to affect the motion of particles and physical objects in space, okay? Or better to say, in space-time. Good. That's nice. And it's not a complete story, yes?
But you can only detect the waves if they come that way to the L, right?
No.
So.
Yeah, exactly. So this is why we have more detectors. I'm going to show you a few figures later. And the thing is that, yes, there is a sensitivity of the waves with respect to the orientation of, well, the sensitivity of the detector with respect to the incoming propagation of the wave. So if the wave is, if the detector is orthogonal with the propagation of wave, you have the maximum signal. But you have a contribution also for different angles, but of course you are less sensitive, okay? That's why, and one detector only can give you information about the direction of the wave, but not complete. As we are going to show you, whenever you have detection from the sky, you are sensible to kind of two stripes, also because you don't know if the wave is coming from one direction or the other, right? So you are fully degenerate with respect to the two directions. That's why there are two detectors, for example. There are more detectors together, in which the antennas are oriented in different ways, also on Earth, so that they are pointing in different directions, also one with respect to each other, they are shifted, to break these degeneracies. And the breaking of the degeneracies is also achieved through the difference in the arrival time of the waves in the different detectors. That tells you if the wave is coming from this direction or the other direction. Okay? So you need more detectors to break these the degeneracies and find out what is the, more information about the wave. Otherwise, you would be insensitive to that. Okay, but later I will show you more about that. Good, as I was saying, this is not the whole story because this just characterizes the wave in itself. But how is it produced? Any object can produce a gravitational wave? No. Production of gravitational waves. To do that, we need to abandon our field equations for vacuum, because vacuum is not a source, because we are setting the source equal to zero. Therefore, what we need to do is to go back to our inhomogeneous equations, in which the source term is different than zero. For which we have a solution. That we derived in the previous lectures. That tells you what is the perturbation given an energy momentum tensor. So the source, what is generating the perturbation. Okay, and here I remind you this was coming out by solving the equation through Green's functions. Green's functions that take care of the retardation of the signal and represent the fact that in this linearized weak field approach that we used, the potential of the gravitational field scales with 1 over the distance, x minus x prime, okay? We are going to use few approximations. which are valid in a broad range of cases, again, not extreme cases. If we are dealing with the last phases of merging of black holes, these approximation breaks. But it's fine for example, a system of black holes. You have two black holes, or a neutron stars and another stars, or a neutron stars and a black hole, doesn't matter, two point masses that are orbiting one with respect to each other at a reasonable distance, where the weak field approximation is valid, and where the motion is non-relativistic. As we are going to see, there is also a loss of energy because we are radiating. It's a gravitational radiation, so the system is losing energy because it's perturbing the space-time. It's moving particles far away, so there is work that is acting on those particles. Means that the system is losing energy, therefore they are spiraling one over each other. Okay, they're falling while spiraling. And while spiraling, velocities goes up, the gravitational field goes up, and all the approximations that we're going to use are not anymore valid. But as I said, for the beginning of, for example, merging systems, this is perfectly fine. So what we are going to do? We are going to take velocities that are way smaller than the speed of light. So non-relativistic velocities. Of course, weak field. No need to repeat that. And then we are taking the source as far away. What does it mean? It means that we are sitting here. This is the whatever object is creating our gravitational wave. And we are going to assume that the size of this object is way smaller with respect to the distance between us and the object, which is true in most, if not all, astrophysical cases. Okay? And this allows to neglect the retardation, because the crossing time of the signal of the system is negligible. So if I get a signal coming from this portion of the object or of that one, it's like they're arriving simultaneously. Okay, the object is very small with respect to the entire dilation retardation that we have on the full baseline. Therefore, we can now apply our approximation for the retardation. So TR is the retardation time, time C is a length. That's equal to what? As it's expressed there in the green, in our solution up there, you see that there is the argument of the energy momentum tensor, which is x0 minus the root of x minus x prime square, right? This is the modulus. I'm basically working up now this, the argument of this equation. You see? That is referring to the retardation time, to the retarded time. Okay, so what we are going to do now is just, I spare you the steps, you have them in the notes, one by one, and they're completely trivial. So what we are going to do is just to approximate this guy equal to L, and we are making an expansion of the square root. That's it, okay? In the notes, you find all steps. And in the end, you arrive at the result that is equal to C, T minus R over C. Now I want you to focus not on these trivial steps, but on the meaning of all of that. And moreover, X minus X prime is roughly X, which we define as R. So that's the distance between us and the source. Okay, so So this is just a way of making an approximation and neglecting the tiny dependency on the angles that we have here. So this is going to be R. If I consider an object here, the object is so small that it's still R, okay? Plus, if I would take the object, the one portion of the object on this size, I should consider this different line of sight. But it's tiny, tiny, because the object is very small, okay? And all of this is neglected. That's the concept here, nothing more than that. In the end, it's a Taylor expansion. That's it. Good. Having that, our gamma mu nu, so the perturbation, is approximated in this way. So we have all the factors that goes in front of our integral. Mu nu, then now is a function of that. I can let this C absorb by the function T mu, therefore I can just write T over R over C, and then I have our X prime that I didn't touch, and this is an integral over the three-dimensional space. And the R went out of the integral, because what do we have here? We had the dependency with respect to X minus X prime, which is roughly R, a constant. Therefore, I can bring it outside of the integral. Okay? This is the same R. Here I've written big letter, but it's the same small R. It's just the distance of the object. Now what we need to do is to work out the integral. Which is quite a tedious and boring exercise. But this boils down to two steps. One is to exploit energy momentum conservation. The nu t mu nu equal to zero. Why there is not the covariant derivative there? Because we are in the weak field limit, and as we have seen, when we apply the conservation laws, it boils down to that. Okay? Which makes the linear theory inconsistent. We are going to see that later, but just remember the fact that energy momentum conservation should have a covariant derivatives here, but in the linearized approach, it boils down to the standard derivative. Okay, so let's exploit that. If this is true, it means that if you take the integral of x, k, delta, nu, t, mu, nu, this is equal to what? Zero. Right? Because this is equal to zero. If this is the case, then I can just, you see I have our repeated index, so I have a summatory. I can break it into terms, the zero component, zero mu, plus the other components, the mu, the x a prime. Now what do we have? I can solve this integral by part. And I can express this guy in terms of a time, right? Because that's the zero, and the zero is equal to dt over c. It's the time derivative with divided by c. That's our zero. I solve this guy by part. One term is going to zero. You know, one term is going to contain the integral of the t of the derivative of the energy momentum tensor, which is the energy momentum tensor. But if I take my integral limits such that the entire source is contained in this volume, meaning this is the source where here t is different than zero, right? Because it's where the source is. Here t is equal to zero because we are in void. If I take my integration volume larger than the source, then this boundary term is going to be equal to zero. It means that in the end, what we get is the integral of t k mu the cube x prime equal to 1 over c, the time derivative of x k t 0 mu integrated over the volume. This is our first result. You see, we can link the derivative, the volume's derivative k, to a time derivative. We are going to exploit this later. Okay? And the steps are very simple. The concept is this guy is equal to zero because of energy momentum conservation. And then we just integrate by part. When the object is completely contained in our integration volume, the boundary condition that we have in the integration part is equal to zero, and we are left only with these two terms. Okay? Again, steps. All steps are on the lecture notes, but these are the two things that we did. Okay? Two. We can now exploit the Gauss theorem. That we have the integral of the derivative with respect to the gradient, with respect of our energy momentum tensor, 0, xL, xk over a volume is equal to 0. So what do we do now? If this is true just because of the Gauss theorem, we just compute it. We just put it, write it down explicitly. So we are going to have the integral with respect to nu of what? T nu zero. So you see I'm just splitting the zero component of x L x k minus the zero T zero zero x L x k in the cube x. Okay, so you see this is j, so this is only 1, 2, 3, so that's the three-dimensional gradient. So what I did here, I computed the gradient over all indices including the zero, and then I subtracted the time component, the time derivative, such that all of this minus that is the gradient with respect to space. Okay, that's the only trick I used here. Now what we can do, we can bring this guy, that's equal to zero because of Gauss theorem, and I just bring it on the other side, all the integral. And now what we have? We have 1 over c dt, which is our derivative with respect to time. The zero is the t over c. Integral of t 0, 0, xl, xk, the cube x, equal to this guy that we brought on the other side, Well, actually, sorry. I can work out even more this expression, in which we have the t over c, I forgot, integral of t L0 xk plus t k0 the cube x. But now what I can do is to exploit the expression that we had before, because we see I have an integral now which is of t L0 xk, and here I have the integral, the time derivative of an integral of xk t 0 mu, you see? That I can now express it in terms of an integral over the energy momentum tensor. So let's call this guy equation 1, and I just use it here, here and here, 1 and 1. Okay, remember that also this term is a time derivative for an integral of tk dx, okay? And xl, of course. Yes. Good. And this leads us to our final result, which is 2c integral of tlk the cube x. And this is our result 2. Now you see, I managed to relate an integral of the energy momentum tensor over a three-dimensional volume to the time derivative of the T00 component only. So here I have an integral for all components, and that is equal to a time derivative of the 00 component only of the energy momentum tensor. This was the trick. That's why we did all of that. And if we did that, now we can exploit that for our perturbation. You see? Now I have an expression for this guy that is not referring to the T mu nu component, but only to the T00 components. So 4G over C square R, where the approximation here is present only because we did we approximated the retardation time. T mu nu, T minus R over C X prime, the cube X prime. So that's what I wrote up there. Now I can take our result and plug it into here. I know how to rewrite this expression in terms of our integral, which is now a double time derivative with respect to time, because I can then compute a time derivative of this guy. Integral of t 0, 0, xl, xk, the cube x. Then we have this one that becomes a 2, this cancel out. And then we have a c to the power of 6. So we are going to have 2g over c to the power of 6, r, and then I can define this object, which is ELK, okay? See, ELK, the indices are inherited by that, which fully characterize our source. ELK for the retarded time t is equal to the integral of t 0, 0 of t minus r over c x prime, x prime, x to the L, x to the K, integrated over the entire space. That's the definition, you see? This is a four momentum. We have a quantity which is integrated by, over a multiplication of xL and xK. This is the four momentum of the T00 component. Why is this convenient? Because we can now approximate this guy for a non-relativistic limit. That's the limit that we are considering. And the T00 component is actually equal to C square rho. So you see, we now just need to know what is the density, the matter density distribution of an object, and we exactly know what is going to be the perturbation that is going to be to produce vortices, C square integral of rho XL XK the cube X. You see? The perturbation, this gives you something, this is a very important result, because it tells you that the perturbation, you get a perturbation in the metric, meaning you get a gravitational wave only for sources, and we are talking about the energy momentum tensor of the sources, because we are looking for the, where is it, there, for the production of the gravitational wave, and you have a signal only if you have double derivatives of the four momentum of your matter distribution. Okay, you see that? Perturbation of the metric is directly proportional to double derivatives of the four momentum of your 0,0 components, of your energy momentum tensor, that in first approximation for a non-relativistic matter distribution is equal to C square rho. Therefore, is related to the four momentum of the distribution. What does it mean? That if you have something that is spherical, even if it's changing shape, therefore there is an evolution in the density, a time evolution in the density, gives you contribution zero, because the four momentum, so if you perform this integral, this is identically zero. Okay? You need something that is asymmetric, such as, for example, two-point masses that are orbiting one around each other. The components, the four momentum of this matter distribution is different than zero. You have a time evolution because they are orbiting, and it's asymmetric. Okay? So that's why we can detect gravitational waves coming from black holes, for example, emerging black holes. So let's try now to make these things practical, and let's try to compute the contribution given by a stellar system. And with stellar system, I mean two-point masses. They could be two stars, could be two black holes, it could be one black hole and one star. Anything of this sort. Now we take the x-axis, so that axis 3, axis 1, and axis 2 oriented in this way. And we take the orbit of the plane in the x2, x1 plane. Okay? So let's say that the orbit is something like that on this plane. So we have mass 1 and mass 2. And for simplicity, I'm taking the mass of the two objects equal. So the mass of the object 1 is equal to the mass of the object 2. Just separated by, this is the orbital radius, which is going to be r, and the separation between the barycenter of the two objects is going to be the same, because the mass of the two objects is the same. And again, for simplicity, I'm going to consider circular orbit. Okay, no ellipticities or these sort of things. Again, for simplicity. With that, we can use a Newtonian approximation. If the two objects are far enough, then at first order we can consider Newtonian gravity for the equation of motion. Okay, we can use Kepler laws. Nothing more than that. And again, this is fine if the two objects are far away. Okay, they are far enough. Therefore, we can define the tangent velocity. Of the two objects. So let's say that this object is moving with a certain velocity v in this direction, and this object is moving with the opposite direction. Again, same modulus because the two masses are the same. Then I can just compute the gravitational potential of gravity equal to the kinetic energy, where we can get a velocity v. Gm over 4r, 1/2. Then we can compute the orbital period out of it. Which is just 2 pi r, so that's the length covered by the objects in one orbit, divided by the velocity. That can give us, in the end, the orbital frequency omega, big omega, which is defined as 2 pi over the orbital period. M over 4r to the 3, 1/2. And with that, we can now have an expression for the position of the two objects in polar coordinates. So in Cartesian coordinates, but expressed with respect to the orbital frequency. Of the object A, xA1 is equal to r cosinus of omega t. For the object B, we have xB component 1 is equal to minus r cosinus of omega t. And the same is going to be for the y component and the y component. So we are going to have for A, xA square equal to r sinus of omega t. And for the object B, we are going to have minus r sinus omega t. We cancel that. So you see, very simple considerations, just to know how the objects are moving, and again, in Newtonian limit, because we are just restricting ourselves to the case in which the two objects are still relatively far one from each other, and the Newtonian gravity can be applied in a safe manner. And of course, if you want to have the evolution of the system through the whole phase of the evolution, where the two objects, as we are going to see, will merge one onto each other, then you need fully relativistic solutions, which is quite complicated. This is quite a challenge also for the detection of gravitational waves, and that's why this approach or similar approaches are used for fast computations and the detection of the waves when they arrive on the detector. Now what do we need to do? We know how the objects are moving. We know their position with respect to time. we can compute what? The quadrupole momentum. To do that, there is just a trick. Then I will stop here, and we'll resume next time. In which we need, you see, the quadrupole momentum is associated to density, right? We are dealing with point masses. Therefore, we need to describe a density for a point mass. How do we do that? Through a delta function. Because the density of a mass point is equal to the mass of the objects, and then the delta function tells you that your object is located at the position xe. The delta function is equal to 1 only when x is equal where the particle is located. This can be split furthermore into the components. You see this is a vector, but I can write it as the delta function of the component 1 minus xe, and then for all components the same. x2, object e, and then again delta function x3 minus x3 component e. Okay? And given the configuration that we have chosen, such that they are in the xy plane, this is always going to be equal to 0. Therefore, our delta function reduces to that. And here, e is equal to object A and object B. So what do? We just compute the 0,0 component of the energy momentum tensor, because it's the one that enters into the quadrupole momentum. And we just plug in our density, rho. And again, here there is an approximation because we are dealing with a non-relativistic term, and the first component is very well approximated by that. Mc squared, and then we just plug delta t, x cubed, which is the position there, and then we have the two components. So this is the total density, so rho is the sum of these two, of the density of the two objects, right? Rho A plus rho B. Therefore, we are going to have the contributions of the two objects here. So we have the first delta function, x1 minus r cosinus of omega t. Now I'm expressing the position with the equations given by Newtonian mechanics and in a Newtonian gravitational field. The cosinus omega t delta d x2 minus r sinus omega t plus the same but for the particle b. Okay, where of course the positions are expressed about the expression that we have there for the particle B. And now what we do, we just have our final result. We have ILK, which is the four momentum that fully characterize the emission of the gravitational wave for the retarded time t, which is equal to t 0,0, then now we know XL, xk integrated over the three-dimensional volume. You see that we have all components for L and K. We just need to make the multiplication, perform the integral. You see there is an integral, but the energy momentum tensor contains these delta functions. It means that the delta function, an integral, just give you the concept. So if you have an integral of a delta function for x over a three-dimensional volume of a function, let's say f of x, okay, this is equal to f of x because the integral is sort of a summatory, as you know, and you're making an integral for all a summatory for all position x where the delta function is equal to 1 only at the position x. Therefore, it's going to be 0, your function, and 0 that gives you that. So you are exploiting this property here because you are all that, you have all delta functions there. Okay? And in the end, you get your final result that I will not write, okay? Because it's too late. You find the expression in the lecture notes, which I can write here, it gives you no additional information. I would like to use this time just to make a short summary of the things that are important, which is the physics expressed in this, on this board. So what we did? We're now looking for dependency of the, we are looking for what is producing the gravitational waves. And what is the gravitational waves are objects which have a quadruple momentum of their zero term of the energy momentum tensor, which is different than zero with respect to its double derivatives with respect to time. Okay, so you need accelerations, such as, for example, in this case, we have two objects that are turning one around each other. This is an acceleration. And you need that the quadruple momentum must be different than zero, meaning you need some object that is asymmetric, because a spherical object, even if it's there are accelerations because it's, let's say, compressing or expanding, gives you zero signal. Okay? So that's the sort of configuration that gives you a gravitational wave. So this is the key point here. Perturbation directly proportional to double derivative of the forward momentum. In the weakly, in non-relativistic approach for velocity smaller than velocity of C, it means that you are looking for the forward momentum of the matter distribution, if you're looking for a matter source, such as in this case. Okay? Then the trick, you see, the steps are very simple. You just look at how your objects are moving or how your energy momentum tensor is moving. You see, once you know how the objects are moving, you get your energy momentum that you can then plug in to find out the forward momentum, and at the end, just get the production of your gravitational waves. Okay? Next lecture, I will give you few other information about this process that involves also a loss of energy and therefore the loss of power and the evolution of the system because of this loss of energy. Okay, thank you very much, and I'll see you next time.